I'm so depressed. Here's my one chance to go on the radio, and do I get to talk about the swarms of young men who worship the ground I walk on? Or about why I'm considered one of the most au courant and vivacious young women in Arkansas? No! I'm supposed to talk about the food pyramid. I'm falling asleep just saying food pyramid. Besides, I don't know a thing about it.
Perhaps I can help, young lady.
Who are you?
I'm Oliver Wendell Farquhar, PhD, CLD, COD, and LALA.
Lala?
Never mind. Just remember that I'm smarter than you. You can call me Science Guy.
Okay, Science Guy. Do you know what the food pyramid is?
Do I know what the food pyramid is? Ha ha ha! Do fish gotta swim? Do birds gotta fly? Do I gotta love that gal till I die? The food pyramid was introduced by the United States Department of Agriculture in 1992 to help non-scientists, like you, understand what you should eat to maintain good nutritional health.
Why is it called a pyramid?
Well, at the base of the pyramid, the largest part, are grains like rice and wheat. The middle of the pyramid is where vegetables and fruits are. And the top of that, but smaller still, are dairy products like 1% milk and yogurt. And at the very top of the pyramid, like the star on a Christmas tree, are proteins like beans and meat.
What? No sugar? No sweets?
Nope. Smart people don't drink soda pop, and they lay very low on high fructose corn syrup. Candy is for holidays. Rice, carrots, spinach, apples, oranges, chili, fish, chicken, and a small scoop of raspberry ripple or chocolate ice cream is for every day. That's the food pyramid.
That's incredibly boring. I don't mean the food. I mean the whole rule thing. Rules for this, rules for that.
You're right. Let's talk about the swarms of young men who worship the ground you walk on. And how you're considered one of the most au courant and vivacious women in Arkansas instead.
I thought you'd never ask.
So, how did it happen? Why are you such a success in everything you do?
Well, naturally, it starts with taking good care of myself. I exercise and watch what I eat.
Oh, you mean that food pyramid stuff?
Gosh, I hadn't thought of that. I'm not just naturally above average. I'm a food pyramid rule follower, too.
Yep. Good looks and nutritional health aren't an accident. It's science.
We're at the Green Forest Farmers Market talking to market manager Brittany Rexwinkle. Brittany, good morning.
Good morning.
What's happening here on the square this morning?
Well, we're having the farmer's market.
Okay, will you walk around and let me talk to some of your vendors?
I sure will. We have a brand new vendor, Tony, over here. He's a school teacher, and he has homemade soaps made with lye and all types of exfoliating agents in them.
Well, let's talk with him and find out about it, all right?
Here's Tony Hafner with his homemade soaps.
Hi, Tony. May I talk with you for the Ozark Harvest Radio Hour?
Sure.
Okay, let me hear what you got over here.
Okay, well, I've got a lot of homemade natural soaps. I don't use any animal products in my soap, so it's completely chemical-free. It's a coconut oil, olive oil-based soap. And I've got a lot of different scents here that I've made. I've got holiday spice, which is pretty good during the winter season, but I still got some left over, so I'm going to try to sell those. They smell really good.
Okay. Now, how does a great, big, strong, strapping guy like you in a Pink Floyd t-shirt get interested in making soap?
Well, my son has severe allergies on his skin. He has eczema pretty severely, and so we've started making a lot of our soaps homemade. Our laundry soap is homemade, and everything is we make ourselves, our shampoo and everything. And I really got into this making soap that would be safer for his skin and for everybody.
Oh, terrific. So if I were to get some of this soap, I'd have soft and beautiful and lovely skin.
I can't guarantee that, but I can guarantee it'll be better than some stuff you can buy in the store.
All right. Thank you so much for talking with us, Tony.
Thank you.
Here's a familiar face. It's Linda Jones, who manages the Berryville Farmers Market. What are you doing over here in Green Forest?
I'm supporting this market as well.
Okay, so you're vending today?
Yes.
And what is it that you have here?
I had squash, green bean, radishes, beets, green onions, snap peas, peppers, lettuce, and potatoes.
Oh, terrific. Is it time for me to dig my potatoes up out in the garden?
Yes, it is.
All right. And are you going to plant anything on top of the where you had the potatoes?
When I get them all up.
All right. Well, that's good. That's good news for me because I'm ready to eat some spuds myself. So, Linda, thank you for talking with us.
You're welcome.
Brittany, tell us when the Green Forest Farmers Market is open.
The Green Forest Farmers Market is each Wednesday from 7 until 12:30 on the Green Forest Square.
All right. Well, I'm really happy I came here. It's always wonderful to have a reason to come to Green Forest, and you guys are the best reason I can think of.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for coming to see us.
Hi, it's
Jane
and Richard, and we're in the garden again this week with you, and this week we want to talk to you about our neighborhood and visit some of the gardens and the people who made them. We're a neighborhood of 12 families along Highway 23 North, and we're of various ages, political views, different religious views, different temperaments, and we don't always agree on things. The one thing that has brought us together is a common well. We have a community well. And through that well, we've grown to know and respect one another and come to agree that homegrown food is the best for many reasons and that neighbors should know and help each other. Of these 12 families, 8 of them are raising gardens right now, and some have gardened for years, and others just began or began again in the past few years. We've developed an informal barter system and trade plants and seeds and tools and advice and eggs and fish and manure and dog and chicken care and the work. And we worked cooperatively the past 2 years to raise steers on one family's pasture, and we're able to supply meat to 9 families.
We partner with another family to raise chickens for meat and butcher them ourselves. We raise chickens and supply several families with eggs. People in return have given us venison, fish, horse manure, chicken feed, scraps, starts of plants, taught us to make tamales, and provided good advice and companionship.
As part of the movement to become more reliant locally, getting to know and work with our neighbors is really important. We've really enjoyed getting to know our neighbors, and if you don't know yours, we encourage you to go out and meet them. Now, that well I was talking about was struck by lightning this morning, and 3 of us are going down to replace on Sunday a couple of the parts that start the well. And while we're working on that, Jane's going to go down and talk with some of the rest of our neighbors, and I'll be talking to you later, and I'll let you know how the well repair goes.
I'm talking to my good friend and neighbor, Reba Potee, and she's going to tell us a little bit about her thoughts about gardening and what she's doing here.
Well, I'm one of those people that is genetically programmed to garden. Having grown up as a child in southern Iowa with my mother gardening, who was an organic gardener way before it was ever thought about being fashionable. We made do with what we had, and we grew a big garden as many people on farms do, because if we didn't grow a big garden, we didn't eat in the wintertime. So all my life, I've planted seeds in the ground come spring. I can't help myself, no matter where I've lived, whether it was in a pot on the front step or the deck, I've been growing food. One of the things that I really enjoy about our community is the sharing of seeds, the sharing of plants, the sharing of ideas on how to garden here in Arkansas. And one of the things I've learned in the last 30 plus years that I've lived here in Arkansas is how to make dirt. Had to learn how to make dirt living on a rock pile, which we do. So that's been a great asset to my gardening. This year we have added another raised bed behind the house using what we had, which was leaves, horse manure, rabbit manure, compost from the kitchen. And we've got a lovely crop of green bush beans and some squash growing in that. And as time goes on, we'll add to it. One of the other wonderful things that we are doing in our neighborhood is raising some meat chickens together. We've also done that with a steer in the past and been very successful and had wonderful meat to enjoy during the winter time. It's great to know where your food's coming from.
I agree.
It's great to have neighbors and friends to share in the crops that you have, and really wonderful to reach into the freezer or into the cupboard or root cellar in the middle of winter when there's ice or snow on the ground and eat food that you grew yourself and loved and cared for and put up in whatever manner that it is you use. So that's kind of what we're doing down here at the end of our road.
Well, thank you, Reba. You've been a great neighbor, and I look forward to many more times together.
Me too.
Well, thanks to Jane and our neighbors for sharing their gardens with us. We've been getting word from some of you to have us come and have you show us your garden, and we're looking forward to seeing you. So go out and get your hands dirty, and have a wonderful week. And we'll see you next time in the garden.